I would, welcome George for and thank him for taking, request for our request, for he is accepting our request to give a talk on how to troubleshoot problems when you're tackling aortic aneurysms. And the best man in the field today, I think, and probably one of the topmost the guys in the world, I would say. I would rate George as one of the best in the world in terms of tackling. I think most of you would agree, or probably all of you would agree, that there's nobody better than George when managing complicated cases and then managing the complications of those cases. And we have seen it happening live in one of our meetings where there were certain issues and all, and he bailed himself out so beautifully after that. So I feel that there's nobody better than George, and being such a wonderful, besides being a great cardiologist, of course, he has studied the aorta so beautifully that to him, like, it's like Virat Kohli or Sachin Tendulkar. He sees the ball like a football, and every ball he probably hits for a six, or maybe name Dhoni also for that matter. So I think nobody better than George to take up this topic. So may I request George to start off with his presentation? We are just touching about 60 people. So I would request George to start off, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bedi. I hope I can live up to all your expectations. I was given a very vast topic. I have, on my own, pruned it down to what you're seeing on the screen now. I was supposed to cover dissections as well, but maybe we'll do that another day.
Yes.
Now, I have selected a few points which I'd like to get across to you. I can't tell you everything that is known, obviously, and you already know most of this. So some of the points I will be presenting may be very familiar to you. So I apologize if it's a duplication or it turns out boring. But anyhow, I'll try to talk about what has made a difference in our practice. There may be small points or big points, but each point I've listed has made a huge difference in our outcomes and helped in reducing complications. So let's get going. I thought I'll just put this up. This is a diagram showing the attachment zones of endografts in the aorta, and they are sometimes also known as Ishimaru zones, but Ishimaru actually described 0 to 4, and all the others were added on. So today we'll be dealing with zones 3 to 11. I'm not touching the arch, and we will be talking only about aneurysms in zones 3 to 11. So before we get into the aneurysm itself, we'll have to start with access. And one of the most important things in access is to know beforehand what your access is going to be like. And I have found that this CT angiogram is a great way of knowing the anatomy of the common femoral artery. And luckily today, CT angiograms are done regularly for all endovascular cases. Only thing is, you must insist that the study includes the common femoral artery so that you get this information. And if you look at the usual window, you just see a white blob as the femoral artery. But if you change that to a bone window, then you see the calcium separately. And in this case, in the right common femoral, there is calcium visible on the posteromedial aspect. And you can also know that this is common femoral because you can see the femoral heads right under the artery. So before you go in itself, you know that there is calcium here. And there is another image, type of image, called the maximum intensity projection, which shows the calcium even better. And so in the same case, you can see there is calcium in the common femoral artery on both sides. And if you look at it in an oblique or a lateral view, you can see that the calcium is posterior. So which is good, which means that you can access the common femoral from an anterior direction, which is what we do, and we should not have problems. And we went on to do the repair that you see on the right. But this is another case where there is a lot of calcium, and here the calcium was anterior, and we didn't look at the CT scan. And after we finished the case, when we had deployed probe-like sutures, but the sutures, when we tied them off, the bleeding didn't stop. Obviously, there was calcium in the wall, which prevented the edges from coming together well. And so we had to press for a long time, and we managed to escape. But if we had looked at the CT well, we could have probably avoided the points where there is calcium and got a better result. So the first point I want to make is that when you do a baseline CT angiogram, make sure that it includes the common femoral arteries, and study the CTA using bone window and the maximum intensity projection images to plan your axis. So after that, you get into the case, and we all know the anatomy of the femoral artery, and we want to puncture the common femoral artery over the femoral head. So we now use ultrasound in all our cases to guide our femoral artery puncture. And we have all become familiar with using this probe. We hold it with the left hand and puncture with the right hand. And the middle image shows you the what we call the Mickey Mouse image. You see the SFA and the profunda as two large ears, and the femoral vein as the face of Mickey Mouse. So this is too low. So you got to move up. And when you move up, you see this common femoral on the right, which is much bigger. And a little deeper, you will see the femoral head. And we puncture with a needle that is called the echo tip needle. And you can see the tip of the needle inside the common femoral artery. So here it's, you have punctured dead anterior, and you have punctured the common femoral, and you know that you're above the bifurcation by 1 or 2 centimeters, and you know that there is no calcium in the wall. So the ultrasound tells you all this in one go. And so this needle that I talked about is manufactured by Cook. It's got this label on top called Echo Tip. And once you put the needle in, you use the micropuncture set, pass the wire, the coaxial dilator. So this is the micropuncture set. I think all of you are familiar with this, but I thought it's worth repeating this because it's a really important bit of equipment. So there is this needle which allows this nitinol wire to go in. Then you remove the needle and pass this coaxial dilator. The inner of this takes the O18, and once it's in, you remove the inner and the wire, and then you can pass the O35 wire. So my second point is that always use ultrasound guidance for common femoral artery puncture. Have a vascular ultrasound probe available and be familiar with how to use it, and use the echo tip needle to puncture the artery. And in fact, this year's Society of Vascular Surgery guidelines have said that ultrasound guidance is recommended for percutaneous access to improve procedural success and decrease the rate of major complications. And this is a grade one, that is a strong recommendation, and the quality of evidence is B. So it is very much recommended. Now, the needle that comes with the micropuncture kit is a 21 gauge needle. This is a much finer tip than the ordinary needle that is available in most labs, which is an 18 gauge needle. And if you look at the tip, the 21 gauge needle tip is considerably smaller than the 18 gauge tip. Now, and it has a shorter bevel. Now, why is this important? This is the problem with long bevel needles. You could have half the bevel in the lumen of the artery and half the bevel in the wall of the artery. And then when you pass a wire, you could actually create a dissection. Whereas if the tip is a fine tip, you cannot be half in, half out. You will be either fully in or fully out. So when you get blood back, you know that you're in the lumen, and when you pass that 1/8 wire, you're not likely to dissect the artery. So always use fine tip needles to puncture any artery, whether it's an open artery in a cut down or percutaneous. Both can result in dissection if you use large or a long bevel needle. And the should you use a percutaneous approach or should you use a cut down for the femoral artery? This year's SPS guidelines say that a percutaneous approach is safe and an acceptable alternative. And they say it, they've given it a grade one recommendation. That means they're strongly recommending it. So in this, it is placed equal to cut down, but I would always use a percutaneous approach because it really reduces the morbidity after the procedure. And we have done cut downs for many years, and for the last 4 years now we have done percutaneous, and I can see the huge difference in the patient's comfort after you use a percutaneous approach. So once you have got your wire in, you want to deploy the ProGlide sutures. Everybody knows how to do this. And earlier on, when we did not use ultrasound, we used to do this. We used to puncture the left femoral artery and bring a pigtail over to the right common femoral, and then make the loop of the pigtail face you, and then puncture into that loop so that you go right in the middle of the artery on the anterior aspect. Now this works. Only thing is you don't get all the other information that the ultrasound can give you. But on three occasions, after I got in, I forgot to remove the pigtail. And then I deployed the ProGlide sutures, and then I couldn't remove the pigtail. And when I tried to pull the pigtail out from the left femoral artery, I could feel the ProGlide sutures getting pulled. And if you try to remove the ProGlide sutures, it will only tighten the knot. So I was really stuck as to how to release this pigtail catheter. Now, what I'm talking about is this. So there is this ProGlide suture which has gone through the wall of the artery and gone through the pigtail. And if you pull either end of this suture, you will only tighten the knot. And I initially thought that the only way out is to get my surgical colleagues to come and release this with a cut down. But then I figured out that if I opened the track down to the artery a little wider, I could get under the knot with a forceps and then pull up. And when I did that, the knot came loose. And then I could just pull one end of the suture and remove it. So this has saved me on three occasions, but I don't face this problem now because I use ultrasound guidance. But I see a lot of people still using that pigtail technique, so they should be aware of this potential problem and how to get out of it. Now here's a thoracoabdominal aneurysm we fixed last month. But the challenge that I want to highlight here is the right iliac artery. You can see it's got a really tortuous course. The left also has a tortuous course. Now, if you want to deploy ProGlide sutures in this artery, the problem is that the ProGlide, that system's length is such that it has to reach the abdominal aorta. And so when you deploy the first suture, you have removed the wire. Then when you reintroduce the wire, the second wire can go and dissect the iliac artery at that bend. So that is an issue. I want to put three sutures. So how do you avoid dissecting the artery? And sometimes the wire just won't go. So you are not able to deploy the next suture because you have to get the wire in after you have deployed the first ProGlide suture in any case. So the way to solve that is to use a pteromohydrophilic wire, which is stiff. And this is so slippery that it will find its way through, and you can torque it a bit and look under fluoro. And once it's gone across, it straightens out this whole bend. And then you can remove the first ProGlide's system, delivery system, bring in the second. Similarly, reintroduce the wire after the second and after the third, and finally put a long sheath in. So hydrophilic thermo wire makes a big difference in getting back into the aorta through a very tortuous iliac artery after you've deployed a ProGlide suture. Then once you are onto the case, so let's say we are doing a thoracoabdominal and we don't have fusion imaging in our lab. So we rely on marking the visceral arteries with a catheter and a wire. So I have usually four visceral arteries to mark, the two renals, celiac and SMA. So I need four arterial accesses apart from the main axis which I have created with ProGlide sutures. So how do we get this four accesses? It's not a great idea puncturing the femoral artery four times. So instead of that, we use this technique. We put in a 12 French sheath or a 14 French sheath on in the left femoral artery, and that's a Cook sheath. And you can puncture the four quadrants of the valve with a micropuncture needle and put a micropuncture wire in and then a O35 wire in. And then you can pass 4F catheters in. And you can pass four of them. And here we passed four of them and marked four of the visceral arteries. Actually, here there are five visceral arteries because there are two renals on the right. So we have marked the two renals, SMA and the left renal, SMA and the celiac. And the left renal is marked from a brachial axis. So we've got the five arteries marked here, but we have only a single puncture in the left femoral artery. So that's a convenient thing. And you can see there is no bleeding because we have not sent these catheters through the center of the valve. We have actually punctured the four quadrants of the valve. It's a rubbery kind of material and it stretches nicely. So once the catheter is in, it sort of grips the catheter and there's no loss of blood. So once you've got your arteries marked, now we want to get to work. So what is the first catheter and wire that you will pass into the aorta? Now everybody's got their own choice of catheters and wires. So if you have something that works, by all means go ahead. But I'll just talk about what we use. And we use what we call the JR Ketch Glide combination. And everybody in our lab is familiar with this. And it's basically a 6 French Judkins Wright diagnostic catheter, which I've marked with a red arrow. And this is a exceptional catheter. There are so many companies which make Judkins Wright catheters, but the Cordis Judkins Wright is the one that has these unique properties. It's got a wire braiding which prevents it from kinking, and it gives you very good torque. So you can torque it, make it look in any direction you want. And then at the end of it, we attach this Y connector called the Ketch, which has a push-pull kind of valve and a sidearm. And then we pass this hydrophilic thermo wire through it. And this is available in three different lengths. Sometimes when you do long exchanges, we use the 300 or 400 centimeter length. Then we have angled and straight and stiff and soft. So we can have various combinations of length, angulation and stiffness. And at the end of this wire, you should use a talking device. And I find this very useful. So you fix it onto the wire and you get very good control of the direction of the tip. And I would strongly suggest you try this. So this combination of the 6F Cordis JR catheter, the Ketch and the Glide is what I put in first. And this catheter preserves its curve at the tip much better than the guiding catheter of the same shape by the same company. And both the catheter and the glide wire are steerable. So you can do a lot of maneuvering. And you can do angiography with the wire inside the catheter. So there is room around the wire inside the catheter to do a fairly decent angiogram. So you don't have to pull out the wire every time you want to do a test shot. And there is also room enough to pass a 035 and an 018 wire. And that's very, very useful, as you will see in our later on and in our fenestration wiring, how these, when you have two wires, you can, it helps to cannulate fenestration target arteries. And you can vary the tip curve by you putting the stiff end of the 035 wire in, but don't let it come out. You keep it within the end. If you push it almost up to the tip, it becomes straight. If you bring it completely back, then it attains its usual curvature. And if it's halfway through, you get various degrees of bend. So you can get a catheter with a bend of any sort that you want by adjusting the position of the stiff end of the wire inside it. All right, so let's move on to fenestration of stent grafts. This is the technique we use all the time. And Edwin was the one who designed this these fenestrators, which we still use. And they're available in a range of sizes. They're circular. We heat them over a flame and we attach the graft at the point where we want to make the fenestration. And then we line the edges with the radiopaque wire, the Fielder wire from Asahi. Only the last 3 centimeters of this wire is radiopaque, so you have to use that end of it. And then we suture it on with 5-0 proline locking, interlocking sutures. And this was published years ago in 2013. And then we resheath the graft. Now this has changed from the past. Now we, this is actually a valiant thoracic endograft. And what we do is every segment of this graft, we tie down with 3-0 proline. And this 3-0 proline must go under one or two struts of the stent in each segment, but it should not go through the fabric. It shouldn't make a hole in the fabric. So there is a small gap between the stent strut and the fabric. So if you're able to pass the needle through that gap, you don't make holes in the fabric. Now, why do we do that? So that when you tie it down, the tie doesn't slip off the that particular stent. It stays right there. So we do that all the way. And then you can see that there are these welds on each segment, yellow arrows, and we line them up so that we know that the endograft is not twisted in any way. And then you just resheath from one end to the other. And as you resheath, you just cut off these sutures. So we don't use umbilical tape if you have done this. You just, the sheath just slides on. And we also have these figure of eight radiopaque markers, which we have pulled off the top of the graft and fixed it at 12 o'clock position. So we bring those up to the surface to tell us how the graft is oriented. And that helps us in correct deployment. So we, as we resheath from one end to the other, we keep cutting off these sutures. And luckily the Valiant has a transparent graft cover. Now we'll talk about the Cook later, but for the Valiant, it's very nice because it's transparent. Right, so let's look at an example of a juxtarenal aneurysm, which we treated with a fenestrated endurant graft. So this was a gentleman who came to us more than 2 years ago. His deficient neck, you can see, and a very tortuous iliacs. In fact, this is the one which his common femoral is the one I showed you earlier, which gave difficulty with the proglide sutures. Now we are trying to fix this aneurysm. So we used an endurant graft with 3 fenestrations, SMA and the 2 renals. And we have constrained this endurant graft with a 5-0 proline suture that goes all the way around, but it doesn't come over the fenestration. So it kind of keeps the fenestration open, yet it constrains the endograft. Now we don't see constraints at higher up. Actually, in this case, we also had made a posterior longitudinal imagination, which was also helping to constrain the graft, but we don't do that very often. So we marked all the three target arteries, and we can see the Lundquist going straight up. And then we deployed the graft. Now the left iliac artery was very tortuous. And when we got a wire through, this is what it looked like. It's got these imaginations. And we put a marker pigtail to measure the length of the common iliac. Now this length is erroneous. It will be too short because the curvature has been straightened out. So you cannot rely on this exact length which the marker pigtail tells you. So we gave an extra 2 or 3 centimeters to the length of the selected iliac limb. And then as you deploy it, you keep stuffing it in so that the end of the graft is just above the internal iliac artery origin. So you can see when we finished, we are very close to the internal iliac origin. And the graft also has an effect of straightening out these loops a little bit. So this is how we finished. We had a good result. There wasn't an endoleak. The fenestrations were flowing and both the iliac limbs were nicely deployed, coming close to the iliac bifurcation on both sides. And 1.5 years later, the follow-up CT angiogram also showed a good result. Now we have moved further from fenestrations to mini cuff augmented fenestrations. Now I'll explain what I mean by that. And now we can use fenestrations in large aneurysmal areas. Now, you know, generally you use fenestrations in sealing zones where the endograft touches the aortic wall, and in aneurysms you use branches. So you have fenestrated and branched endografts, or a combination of the two. Now, if you want to use a fenestration inside an aneurysmal zone, you could run a risk of endoleak, a type 3 endoleak coming around the fenestration stent, because the overlap between the fenestration stent and the fenestration is just the edge of the fenestration. That is very little. So if you can augment that with something and improve the sealing, then you may be able to use fenestrations in aneurysmal areas. And then we also developed a way of pre-cannulating this so that it's easy to cross them. So let's look at how we make this what we call augmentation. So A is the endograft, 2 blue lines. We made a fenestration in B, and then we lined the edges of the fenestration with radiopaque wire in C. Then we bring a surgical graft, which is of the same diameter as the fenestration. And it's a PTFE graft, and it's about 2 centimeters long. And we allow about a centimeter or a millimeter to project out. And then we suture it onto the edge of the fenestration with non-locking 5-O proline. And then we evert the graft outwards, and then we trim it down to about 3 or 4 millimeters length. Then we balloon dilate it so that any wrinkles are moved out. So the balloon is of the same diameter as the fenestration, and which is also the same diameter as the surgical graft. And then to prevent invagination, we have these relaxed stay sutures fixed at the edges of this surgical graft. So this is what it looks like. In B, you can see a couple of mini cuff augmented fenestrations. And we've used this in a patient with a type 4 thoracoabdominal aneurysm who's in renal failure and on dialysis. So we plugged off the 2 renal arteries and made these 2 fenestrations for the celiac and SMA, and that's the result we got. So this is inside a large aneurysmal area, and there is no leak from the edges of the fenestration at all. That's the follow-up result on the right. And here's another case, another type 4 thoracoabdominal or bordering on juxtarenal, where the renals come off the aneurysm and the SMA celiac are from the non-aneurysmal zone. So we made augmented fenestrations for the renals and just plain fenestrations for the SMA and the celiac, and that's the result on the right and the follow-up on the extreme right. So now we wire these fenestrations to make it easy to cross them. So this is now a Cook endograft, and we found a very handy way of using Cook endografts, that is by opening them from the back end. So there is this black peel away sheath kind of thing at the back end of the Cook endograft, which goes into the valve that is there. And we push that in maximally. And then you pull this gray rod, and that brings the whole graft out. So then take the whole graft out. We just take the part of the graft that we are interested in. And you can see the rest of the graft is still inside. And now we make fenestrations. Here we made three fenestrations, and we wired them. And these wires, they loop around, and both ends go into this gray rod, which is hollow. And then we, one end is remains in that gray rod, the other end comes out through a hole we make in this rod, and we put a 4F dilator in, and it comes out through that. So if there are three wires, there will be six ends. Three ends come out, three ends stay within the this gray rod. Okay, so when you remove the delivery system, you will have six wires coming out. And if you have this sheath with you, then things are really cool, because you can pass any number of catheters and wires through this gore dry seal sheath, and there won't be any bleeding. Unfortunately, we don't have this in India. So we have made our own contraption, I could say. So we use the 18F Cook sheath and puncture the valve with at four places and put four short 4F catheters in. And through the central lumen, we put a 6mm balloon in. And that's the back end. And at the front end, it looks like this. So these catheters, we trim it so that they just project by a few centimeters. And this is that 6mm balloon. So the in this case, we want to pass four wires through the valve, but not through the central hole of the valve, but through the four quadrants. So when you feed them into these four catheters, they'll come out of the four quadrants. And then you remove the catheters, so only the wire is left. And this balloon will then go on the Lundquist. And then when you inflate the balloon at the tip of the valve, it serves like a dilator. So on the right, you can see this sheath going in with the balloon serving as a dilator and the wires on the side of the balloon. So in this case, we have marked three vessels and we have three wires for these three vessels. So what is the use of these wires? If you go over either end of the wire, you'll come out of a fenestration. And these are the mini cuffs. And this wire is woven 8. So this 6F Judkins diagnostic catheter will allow a parallel thermo wire to come out, and you can send it down your target artery. So if your endograft is deployed with the fenestrations oriented towards the target arteries correctly, then this is very easy. The wire will just go into the target artery. Similarly, from the other end of the wire, you can go into another target artery if it's a loop that goes through two fenestrations. But if a fenestration has its own independent wire, then only one end can be used. The other one is lying free. So you can use wires, a shared wire for two fenestration or a single wire for each fenestration. This was this technique was published a couple of weeks ago in Vascular. And we'll now see how we use it. So this is another juxtarenal aneurysm and very short neck. And you can see that a regular intrarenal repair will not work. And the other point here is that there is only a single mesenteric vessel. It's a SMA celiac combined artery, or you could say the celiac comes off the SMA. And so we made a large fenestration for the SMA celiac and two renal fenestrations. And this is a Cook graft, and this is the back end, which we have opened, and we've cannulated each separately. So three wires for three fenestrations. And this is the picture I showed earlier, the three arteries marked, and then the system going in. And then we deploy the graft. And now you can see that on one, the left renal wire, we are bringing an agilis sheath, and that has gone through the fenestration and it's looking at the left renal artery. And we passed a parallel wire into the left renal artery. So once you're in, you remove the wire and the original pre-cannulating wire and work on the wire you've passed in. So this is the result we got. We put stents into the three fenestrations, and we actually used a large fluency stent in the SMA celiac artery because it was so big. And we extended downwards with a bifurcated endodont, which went into the two iliac limbs. So this is how we finished on top. And this is the follow-up CT angiogram, I think about a year later. So it looks good, there are no leaks. Now we could have problems in the iliac artery or femoral artery during or after the case. And this is a patient who had a thoracoabdominal type, what we would call type 5, Safi's type 5. And the access vessels looked pretty good. It's a lady. Access vessels looked pretty good, so we didn't anticipate any problem. So the procedure went well. So this was a large aneurysm with ending above the renals. And so we had this Valian graft with four fenestrations, and we constrained the renal and the SMA part of this graft because that is in the narrow part of the aorta. The celiac artery came off the aneurysm itself, so we didn't constrain it. This is before our augmentation. So these are plain fenestrations. And you can see the constraints are with this 5-0 proline sutures that don't go in front of the fenestration. They start at one edge and then end at the other edge. They go right around the graft. So they are sub-circumferential. Right, so this is, after we deployed it, we cannulated all the four vessels, and then we brought a Koda balloon and broke the constraints, and then we proceeded to stent the four arteries, and everything went well, a nice result at the end. So we're very happy, pulled out the sheath, tied the proglides, and then the anesthetist said, I'm not getting a blood pressure. And we then had lost the right femoral axis. So we had a left, so we came in from the left, and we got a balloon down. This was a rupture. And we have occluded the right common iliac artery, and they're injecting through the wire lumen of that balloon, and you can see this huge rupture, which we couldn't do anything about. You know, the patient had absolutely zero pressure. When we punctured the right femoral, we got into the vein. This wire is in the vein, actually, and we couldn't get that access again. And we lost the patient on the table after a great endovascular result. So the problem, we looked at it, and after we had removed the endograft delivery system, we had put this 20 French sheath in. And this and the 18 French are made by Cook, but there's a lot of difference in the handling characteristics. The 20 French is quite a stiff, rigid kind of sheath. And it's of course 2 French bigger. And we had used a 22 French system, so we thought 20 French sheets should be correct. The 20 French is the inner diameter, so the OD is 22. Now we have realized that whatever size device you use, you can even use a 25 French endograft delivery system. The hole you make is closed by an 18 French sheet because there is some elasticity to that puncture that you make. So 18 French is enough. Besides being smaller, this sheath is much more flexible and it doesn't traumatize the iliac so much. So after that case, we've never had this problem again. And we only use 18 French sheath, even if we have deployed a endograft which has a delivery system up to 25 frames. And the other things, two other things we do is at the end of the case, we pull the sheath down to the just above the inguinal ligament and do a sheathogram to see if there is a rupture. If there is, you just put the dilator in and push the sheath back up. So you don't even need a balloon. You can stop the bleeding. And don't remove the Lundquist wire or whatever wire you have going through the iliac artery, because if you have removed that and you have a rupture, very difficult to get back in. And of course, you must have fluency stents on your shelf to deal with this situation. So we have these long fluencies, which are like 9 or 10 millimeters in diameter, which can occlude a ruptured iliac artery very quickly without much blood loss. So I had talked earlier about constraining these endografts. So we look at this thoracoabdominal aneurysm in a very calcific aorta, and here the celiac and superior mesentery come off the aneurysmal part, but at the renal level the aorta is narrow and there's already a renal stent in place in this patient. So we used a valine graft with 4 fenestrations, and you can see the celiac and the SMA, we have not constrained the graft as much as at the renal level, which is in, going to go in that narrow part of the aorta. And this is the result we got at the end. So it's basically to show you this constraining of a valiant graft. Another example, here's an aorta with, intrarenal aneurysm with a short neck. So we decided to land above. So we made 3 fenestrations, 2 fenestrations for both the renals. And this is the suture that's going around. And this suture goes under and then over. Under and then over. So when it goes around, it's not outside every strut. It's under alternate struts and over alternate struts. And you can see that it's not gone through the fabric. It has gone between the strut and the fabric. So you don't induce any tear when you tighten, and you don't make holes when the needle goes through. And then it ends on both sides of the fenestration, but doesn't go over the fenestration. If it goes over the fenestration, it may, make the fenestration oval or slit-like. So this is how we constrain an endurant graft. So this was the baseline angiogram, and this was the outcome. And for the SMA, we used a chimney to simplify the procedure. And we had 2 fenestrations for the renals. And lower down, we ended at the iliac bifurcation as usual. So constraining of fenestrated endografts is done using 5-O-proline and sub-circumferential ties. And you must stop at the edge of the fenestration. And then you go under and over the struts as you go around the graft. And you do not go through the endograft fabric with the needle. And you cannulate all fenestrations in the constrained zone before you break these ties. Because if you cannulate one and then you break it, then the other fenestrations will oppose the wall. And then you cannot make use of the constraint that you had. So you have to cannulate all the fenestrations in the constrained zone, and only then can you bring a Koda balloon in to break the constraints. Okay, now we have a situation where the visceral aorta has some thrombus, and we've deployed a fenestrated endograft, and this was the aneurysm, and this is a lady, and this is probably a type 3. Thoracoabdominal, and there is, so there is one renal artery on the right, which you see here. There is no left renal artery, and this is the right renal artery, and there is thrombus in the aorta lining the aneurysm, and the lumen is about 30 millimeters. So we this repair has to start in the descending aorta. So the endograft there, we thought will be about a 30 or so. And then here, we need another 30 because it has to match that. So I think on top, we use the 32-28 tapering and then put this 30 into that 28 lower part of the descending aortic endograft. Yeah, that's what we did. So we, in the descending aorta, we had a 32-28 tapering. And then in the visceral aorta, we had this 30-30-192. And then lower down, we had the bifurcated 32-16-166 in the intrarenal abdominal aorta. Cuffed fenestrations with wires. And we have constrained the visceral segment. And then after deploying it, we cannulated the fenestrations, brought the Koda balloon, broke the fenestrations, put the fenestration stents, finished the case. Great result. No endoleak. Yeah, this was how we finished. Some type 4 leak there, but we don't expect that to persist. Next day, she became acidotic and lactates went up. And then she developed fever, hypertension, tachycardia, went into septic shock, renal failure. And within 48 hours, she was dead after a great result. And this kind of sequence of events made us think that it must have been a mesenteric ischemia due to embolization from the aorta. And that must have happened when we brought the Koda balloon in and dilated the graft to break the constraints. And that would have kind of squeezed the thrombus and toothpasted it into the SMA. So we now don't dilate endografts in the abdominal aorta if there is thrombus in the aneurysm, because you may dislodge thrombus and cause mesenteric ischemia. And also in the abdominal aorta, in the visceral segment, we try to use the smallest endograft that you can get, which is actually 22 millimeters. So that, you know, you may even avoid constraining them completely. So after this event, we very luckily stumbled upon this tapered endograft from Cook. So we'll see a case how we use it. This is another thoracoabdominal aneurysm. And we need, this is probably a type 2. We're going to start the repair way up there and end in the common iliacs. And this whole thing is lined with thrombus. So really dangerous for embolization. And so this is the angiogram. We're going to start a repair over here. And the celiac artery was occluded very fortunately because it made our job simpler. So we just have to deal with the SMA and the two renals. So we use this Cook graft, which is the TX2-32-22-162. So it's got a 10 millimeter taper, and that is really helpful for us because the 32 on top will overlap nicely with whatever descending aortic endograft you've got. And 22 will bring the diameter down so much that you don't need to constrain this graft at all. And you can extend it with a bifurcated graft, which is 25 or so. So we have opened the back end of this graft, three fenestrations, cannulated them like before. And here we have deployed it. And you can see how rapidly this taper is occurring. You know, it's 32 on top and 22 below. And so in this visceral segment, we didn't have to constrain and we didn't have to balloon. That's the most important thing, you know, because the thrombus lying outside shouldn't get disturbed. So this is a valiant 32 on top. And then there is this 32-22 coming down, which has these three fenestrations. And right at the bottom, we have a endurant bifurcated 25-16 in both limbs. And that's the final result of this case. So these tapered visceral aortic endografts, preferably use the 10 mm taper because that really brings the diameter down. And we want it as low as possible. And unfortunately, there's nothing smaller than 22. And some visceral segments are actually much smaller than 22. So we may still have to constrain. But they are large enough on top to overlap the endograft in the descending aorta, and they're small enough in the abdominal aorta to avoid constraining. And of course, they should be long enough for good overlap on both ends. So Cook has a 160 millimeter length and a 200 length. So the 200 gives plenty of overlap zone on both ends of the endograft. There's another problem called guide wire bias in the fenestration zone. And if you have a small aortic branch taking off at right angles on the side of guide wire bias, that is one of the most difficult branches to cannulate. So here's a thoracoabdominal aneurysm. And if you look carefully on the right side, there are two renal arteries. The upper renal artery comes off this narrow portion, and there is a bend in the aorta there. And it's coming off that bend. And there's the lower renal artery here. So this renal, the upper renal on the right, is in a very unfavorable position because the guide wire will bias everything toward that side. So even if you constrain the graft, it will be biased to that wall and it will always be opposed to the wall. So there is not going to be any room to maneuver outside the graft. So we made a, that is the yellow arrow shows this upper right renal artery, which is going to be where the guide wire is going to bias. And the lower right is well away. And so we hope to end our repair above the lower right. And we made a fenestration for the upper right. And of course, for the celiac SMA and the left renal. So this is what we made. We took the same tapered Cook endograft. And we have mini cuffs for three fenestrations, but no cuff for the right renal. And we wired everything. And we made the right renal a little low so that when you come out of the fenestration riding on this wire, you head towards the right renal artery. So this is the baseline angiogram, right renal is up there. And this is the marking wire, and we brought the endograft in, the delivery system. Yellow arrow shows the renal fenestration on the right side. It's kept a few millimeters below the marking wire. And then we release the graft. Unfortunately, we couldn't get into that renal artery, try as we might. And there is very little or no space there. So because we had that wire, we could at least close that fenestration. And we put a plug, a PDA device actually, and closed that unused fenestration. And the renal on that side, because the graft is opposing it, it will also close up. So there shouldn't be a type 2 leak later from that renal artery. And we ended the repair above the lower right renal artery. The other fenestrations were quite easy. And so we finished like this. And his CREAT, which was 0.9, has stabilized at 1.4. He has lost about 2/3 of his right kidney. So that is a setback, but this was a very difficult renal artery to save. Now there's another kind of guide wire bias, which I'll show you, where the fenestration can land very far away from the target artery. So here's a type 4 thoracoabdominal with two renal arteries on the right, SMA celiac, one left, and this patient from, I think he's from Siliguri, very symptomatic, large aneurysm on the verge of rupture, groaning in pain. So we planned a 5 fenestrated repair with a valiant endograft, 26-22, it's got a 4 mm taper, cuffed all the fenestrations. This was before we started wiring them. And so these are the 5 fenestrations, 2 right renals over here at the bottom, SMA celiac, left renal. So when we put the wire in, we found that the wire is biased towards the patient's left side. And we hadn't anticipated this bias. And when we brought the endograft in, It is way to the left, and you can see over here, all the marking catheters are to the right of this endograft delivery system. And the celiac is also to the right. So that is a problem. And when we deployed it, we couldn't rotate it, because if you rotate it, the renals will go haywire, because they have to look sideways. The renals were 3 and 9 o'clock. So we had to deploy it as we, you know, with this figure of eight looking at us. So what happened is the celiac fenestration is much to the left of the celiac artery. So you can see this gap over there. And the SMA is also to the left of the fenestration, or the fenestration is to the left of the artery. The renals were okay. So we got everything except the celiac. And we really struggled with the celiac until we hit upon this idea to use this Agilis steerable sheath, which is used by our electrophysiology colleagues quite a bit. And we got this sheath through the celiac fenestration and pointed it to the patient's right. And when we do an angiogram, you can see this marking catheter of the celiac, and you can actually see the celiac artery here. And you can see the fenestration over here. So there's this gap between the fenestration and the artery, and the artery is going down. So how do you, you know, link these two? So this Agilis sheath is great for that. So you just drop a wire in from the sheath into this artery. Because the sheath is looking down, it goes into the artery. And then over that, we passed a 4F catheter. And then we pulled the sheath back and straightened it. And as we did that, the catheter also straightened and formed a straight path from the fenestration to the celiac artery. So you can see that happening over here. So we've got it back till there, and then we could advance the catheter over the wire into the celiac artery. So there's the catheter going into the celiac artery. And then it's all very easy. You pass a stiff wire and a long sheath and deploy a stent. And we put two stents, first a short covered stent ending in the celiac, and then a self-expanding bare metal stent going into the hepatic artery. So that gives it a little more support. And then we use the same Agilis for the left renal, which is not wired. It's a cuffed fenestration. And this sheath is able to nose its way through that fenestration into the left, towards the left renal artery through the fenestration. We've already stented the two right renal arteries. And so this is the final result. It was quite nice. And this is the lateral view showing the celiac that we fixed, SMA, and that's the bifurcated endograft that goes into the common iliac arteries. So the stent that we put into the each branch, it can fracture. And in India, we have this live stream stent, covered stent, balloon expandable, and we have this B graft, peripheral. This is more conformable than the live stream, but both of them are pretty thin, single layer of graft material. And we also had this one earlier called the Xylene. It's made by Insitu Technologies, an American company. So we actually started using a lot of the Xylene because they were offering a lower price, but there was a price to pay. And you'll see that in this case. So this is another thoracoabdominal who came with a rupture, and this purple is something like a contained hematoma. And this ends at the renal artery, this aneurysm starts in the mid-thoracic. And this is, the yellow arrow shows that contained rupture. It's outside the calcium of the aorta. So quite symptomatic. And here's the aneurysm ending at the level of the renals. And this is the endograft we used, a Valiant with I think four fenestrations. Here the celiac is quite high. The top of the graft is on the right of the image. And this is the SMA, and through the SMA fenestration, you can actually see the right renal fenestration. And this is the left renal fenestration. So four fenestrations, deployed it, cannulated everything. For the celiac, because it's a long tortuous route through the aneurysm, we put a fluency stent. And that's not very flexible. And you can see it's sort of sitting at a right angle to the artery at the distal end. But 4 millimeters of the stent is not covered. So there is good flow there, although not looking very nice. And the other three fenestrations, we put this silene stent. So this was May 17. And then he came back to us in December 17, asymptomatic. But when we did this CT angiogram, we saw this. The SMA stent was in two pieces. And the point where it broke, the stent had sort of collapsed to occlusion. And there was thrombus. The yellow arrows show the thrombus in the part of the stent just where it broke. And the aorta is, of course, patent. There's no endoleak. But the SMA stent is in two pieces. And because he's asymptomatic, he's obviously collateralized from the IMA. And we didn't do anything because suppose you open this broken half here, you may not be able to get into the broken half distally. And you would have a lot of endoleak while we're doing all that. And this thrombus may migrate down and he's asymptomatic. So we decided to leave this alone. But for the other three stents, here's the broken silene stent marked with the red arrow. So for the two renal silenes, we lined them on the inside with self-expanding bare metal stents, the Everflex. We get them in 2 centimeter lengths. And similarly for the celiac, which had that angulation at the tip, we took a bare metal stent self-expanding beyond the tip to sort of straighten out that sharp angulation. So this is what we did with the celiac. And then followed up a year and a half later, all these three stents are doing well. Here on the right, you can see the celiac stent where these two bright dots is the end of the fluency. And then the next two dots are the self-expanding stent going beyond and smoothing out this bend. Renals are doing well. And SMA, of course, is in two pieces, that SMA stent. Now you can see this large IMA, which has taken over the role of the SMA. Right, so now we have another case where the silene broke. And this is also SMA. And here there was a leak, but sort of a contained leak. So this is an angiogram through the SMA fenestration. And you can see the distal SMA here and the two halves of this broken silene. So we bridged that with a fluency endograft and got a good result. Nowadays, in the West at least, they use this stent, the B-graft plus peripheral, which has got two layers of graft and is much more robust. And some are also using the Viaban VBX, which is also a great endograft. And if you use this, then you don't need to line them on the inside. But unfortunately, we don't have these stents. So we're not in a position to use them. So currently, what we do is to line all these covered stents with self-expanding bare metal stents when we use it in the abdominal segment. I've been talking continuously. I don't know if I should stop for questions or just go on till I finish.
I suggest you finish, George, and then I think there will be, I'm sure, a lot of questions.
Okay. All right. So I've got only another 6 points to go. Okay. So you can also get a disconnect of the fenestration stent. So here's a patient with thoracoabdominals. We've seen this a little earlier. We had a renal stent put in earlier. The left renal is stenosed. This is quite some time back. So this is a Cook graft which we have opened from the top end. We made 4 fenestrations, deployed it. And there was this small leak around the right renal artery. We didn't know where it's coming from. We blew up the stent a little more, still there. Then we put a glue in the sac still there and put a PAMA stent in the overlap zone, then it went. So there was a an overlap problem between the fenestrated stent and the next stent below. Then he did well and there was no leak. This was in 14. And then in 15, he came with a leak. And this time, it was a totally different situation. The fenestration stent in the right renal fenestration had popped out. And it was looking in a different direction altogether. You know, you can see that stent there and the fenestration here. And there is contrast coming out and a large endoleak and repressurization of this sac. And we really couldn't get into this stent from this fenestration because they are looking in different directions and they're not coaxial, really struggled. And then we fell back onto our usual lifesaver, the Agilis sheath, and got the sheath out of the fenestration and then straightened it out to look at the stent. And then with the sheath looking at the stent, we were able to put a thermo wire down the stent and then a catheter over it. And then we were able to put a stiff wire and then it brought the stent back into alignment with the fenestration. And then we put a long stent to bridge that gap and made sure it was quite robust, and projected it by a whole centimeter, and that was the final result. And this is a follow-up CT now showing no endoleak in that. This is a follow-up CT probably 2 or 3 years later. That stent is still doing well. All the fenestrations are doing well. A lot of calcium in this aorta. Right, so now we talk about how you can preserve flow into the internal iliac arteries when you extend your repair to the external iliac artery. External iliac artery, which is zone 11 now. And this is a complex thoracoabdominal extending into the common iliac arteries. And there are two right renal arteries. And the internals are coming off a narrow segment of the common iliac. The end of the common iliac is narrow. And that's where the internal comes off. So it's a bit of a problem. The usual iliac branch device won't work here because there's no room near the internal for that. And also there is all this tortuosity, a lot of complexity to this case. So we decided to do it like this. We had a 5 fenestrated graft in the visceral aorta and we had this iliac limb with a single fenestration, which is cuffed and wired for the internal iliac artery. And we made 2 of these, for one for each side. So we deployed the aortic one first, and that there was another graft above that, and that's the celiac being cannulated. And then we brought these 2 pieces in, right one first and then the left one. We marked the renals from the break, and the internal iliacs from the brachial, and had to do a kissing balloon to create some space. And then we didn't have enough support trying to bring a stent in. So finally we got the support by creating a femoro-femoral wire loop over which a 10F sheath came over. And then through this 10F sheath, we brought a 6F sheath. And that went into the internal iliac and delivered the stents. And we were able to do this on both sides. So a femoro-femoral wire loop over which a 10F contralateral sheath comes provides the necessary support to introduce internal iliac stents through a coaxial 6F sheath. And so finally we got this result. All the 5 fenestrations in the abdominal aorta and the 2 iliac, internal iliac fenestrations were stented. And this is the follow-up result. The aneurysm is thrombosed, all the stents are patent, and especially the internal iliacs are flowing. And so we can use the same technique, that is using the iliac limb, making a fenestration on the iliac limb for in another situation where you want to preserve the inferior mesenteric artery. So this was done last month, very complex. I showed you this earlier where we talked about the iliac tortuosity. So this patient has a something equivalent to a type 2 thoracoabdominal. There's saccular aneurysms in the thoracic aorta and this huge fusiform one lower down. His inflammatory markers are very high, so probably a Takayasu. And this aneurysm was 14 centimeters across and a lot of thrombus. It was also very symptomatic. And all his visceral arteries were occluded except the inferior mesenteric. So this is the sole blood supply to his abdominal viscera, and the two renals get collaterals from the internal iliac artery. So in this case, we have to preserve this IMA and the two internal iliac arteries and exclude this aneurysm from possibly the subclavian down to the common iliac. So we put the first graft, the valiant, just beyond the subclavian, and then a bifurcated graft. And then this bifurcated graft was extended with two iliac limbs on both sides and ended in the common iliac. And the left side, the lower limb had a single fenestration for the IMA. And that is looking dead anterior because the IMA origin is anterior. And we marked the IMA with this agilis sheath, which is curving downwards. And this graft is ending at the iliac bifurcation. And this was that graft, that iliac limb, which had a cuffed fenestration, which was wired. And one end of the wire was extrudized from the brachial artery. So from the brachial, we came and crossed the fenestration, entered the internal iliac and put in a stent. And that's what you see in the left panel. There is two stents here. One is a balloon expandable life stream, and inside that a self-expanding bare metal stent. And it's projecting into that limb by maybe 5-6 millimeters. And that's the two iliac limbs. And you can see there's large IMA collaterals going up and supplying all his viscera. And renal function stayed good. And he's gone home on immunosuppressive therapy. Now, often we need access from above, and sometimes we need multiple accesses. And so we have got a way of getting multiple percutaneous accesses from the left axillary artery. So we puncture this artery, if you want three accesses, three large accesses like 9 French, we puncture the artery 3 times, not lower down, but just outside the chest cage. So it's actually a high axillary puncture. So we punctured it 3 times, 3 wires go in and 3 sheaths are put in. And it looks like this, 3 sheaths, these are 7 French sheaths going into the left axillary artery. You can upsize this to 9F long sheaths. And if you want to do work in the abdominal aorta where you need 3 sheaths, this is the way we do it. And then we deploy a fluency stent across these 3 puncture points and then pull out these 3 sheaths all in one go. And we have a wire across and a catheter here testing whether we have any leak. In this case, there's no leak. If there's a leak, you can quickly come on the same wire and put another stent in case you missed one of the puncture sites. But this is a very handy way of getting multiple 9F, up to 9F we've gone. These are, you can have 3 9F sheets going down like this. And then if you want to go back in, you can puncture this stent and go back in. And it's a great access because you can see it, you can under fluoro directly puncture the stent and put another 9F sheet back in. And then when you remove the second time, we put an angioseal device and close the hole. And so we have we don't lose the axillary artery for access. In fact, we create a handy access for the future. Right, we can use the same technique supraclavicularly for the left subclavian artery, and this is a patient with an ascending aortic, something like a blowout. It's probably a pseudoaneurysm, really giant pseudoaneurysm, and we wanted to exclude its mouth by putting an endograft in the ascending aorta. And so this endurant aortic tube, which is 5 centimeters in length, is what we use, but its delivery system is too short. It won't come from the groin to the ascending. So we had to bring it in from the supraclavicular subclavian artery. That is very nice. It comes straight down in a, almost like a straight line. So we got good control and deployed it. And then we remove it and put the same fluency stent to close that. That was about a 20 French hole. And we have punctured the artery in this region above the clavicle. And then this is the result we got. We just about managed to exclude that aneurysm. A slight leak here, but that settled down. And, now in the next few months, we hope to get a new graft called the Valiant Navion, which has got a long delivery system, much better. We don't have this free flow segment with these barbs. It will be much better for the ascending aorta. So we're really waiting for that to do such cases in future. So I'll stop with this last point. This is the SVS guidelines this year about CSF drainage. And when you do these long repairs, they don't say that you should always use a prophylactic CSF drainage. They say that use it when the risk for sinusoidal cord ischemia is deemed to be high. And they give a number of examples, extensive coverage, previous aortic coverage, where you're compromising the internal iliacs, where the vertebral is going to be occluded, or subclavian is going to be covered. And so we use CSF drains prophylactically only if the patient is at high risk. Otherwise, we keep the mean arterial pressure above 90 throughout the procedure and for the next 2 days. And we stop antihypertensive treatment on the day of the procedure. And we always preserve the left subclavian artery and the internal iliac arteries. So those are very important sources of spinal cord blood supply. And we don't combine thoracic and abdominal procedures if possible, but then you saw some cases where we had to. And we don't give antiplatelet drugs before the procedure, because if you want to put in a spinal drain and he's on antiplatelets, then you may get a bloody tap, and that can be a result in a hematoma. And then we monitor neurological function every 30 minutes and postoperatively right through the night. And if there is any sign of neurological deficit, then we put in the drain. And we have our anesthetist readily contactable, and we have told him that, see, there's a case like this. We'll call you if there's a problem. And we've had to put in drains in 2 or 3 cases like this. But we managed to reverse the deficit because we were very prompt in that. Thank you for your attention.
I think I'm absolutely speechless, George. I think the kind of presentation that you made, I think it shows your entire intense effort which is there, which has gone into this kind of work, the kind of extensive work and experience which is there on the chat box. A lot of compliments coming to you. And really very, very impressive body of work that you've done. And I think it, your passion shows. Recently, I just finished reading the book, which was a biography written by somebody like Michael Lawrence Brown. I don't know whether you know the guy who invented the Cook Zenith device. In fact, the initial person. And I see a lot of shades of MLB in George Joseph today, because I think the kind of work that you're doing, stupendous kind of newer interventions, you're using the graft, but then modifying them in such a way that it's amazing to see. I see some awesome work coming in, excellent presentation, a class apart work. And my friends, from you had about 100 plus viewers right now watching this presentation, I think, which is a record on a Saturday evening. Nobody is doing anything else but watching George show some wonderful cases. So there are a few questions. I hope you will not mind you know.
No problem at all.
We are flabbergasted. We are, congratulations, George, mind-boggling. So this, of course, is all the compliments which are coming to you. So I'll just ask a couple of questions.
Sure.
One is, of course, from Murali, that can you explain again how the mini cuff has advantages over a plain fin?
Yeah, so basically it improves the sealing. So mini cuff increases the overlap between the fenestration edge and the fenestration stent to about 3 or 4 millimeters. Otherwise, it's just 1 millimeter. So right. If you have a leak from around a fenestration stent, there's very little you can do about it. You can only keep blowing up that stent and hoping that the leak will stop. So you don't normally use fenestrations inside an aneurysm. You only use fenestrations in the landing zone where there is a branch taking off. Inside an aneurysm, you're expected to use branches, a branch device. Now, when you have cuffed fenestrations, because you have better sealing around the fenestration edge, you can use a regular cuffed fenestration. So that is the advantage. So the cuffed fenestrations, they don't have a direction to it. See, branches are either down or up. Cuffed fenestrations can be used upwards or downwards or horizontally. So that's an advantage. Right. And they also need shorter stents to reach the target, because they're not, hanging way up. And then, you know, branches require covered stents which are 6 or 8 centimeters long. Here we just need 2, 3, or sometimes 4 centimeters, very rarely more than that. Right. So that's the main advantage.
Great.
Using
Covera stent because we find it very, very soft kind of a stent. So we always prefer to use the balloon expandable ones. But would you consider using a Covera anywhere in this one, the new barge stent which has come in?
If I'm not mistaken, it's a self-expanding covered stent. Is that correct?
That's right.
Yeah. Right. I did use the fluency in one or two of these fenestrations where the path was long. So nothing wrong with that, but what we want is good radial strength at the fenestration edge. That's why we use balloon expandable covered stents, and then we line it with the bare metal stent so that it doesn't fracture in future, and it absorbs the movement with each respiration. These branches, they move up and down and they put a strain on the rigid covered stent. So to overcome that, you put this self-expanding stent, and the combination should theoretically work. We've never seen a fracture of a balloon expandable covered stent lined with a self-expanding bare metal stent. But then our experience is probably not enough to make that statement very...
Dr.
George, you're being very, very modest. I mean, I don't think anybody will have more experience than you. This is just stunning wizardry. I mean, this is phenomenal.
Yeah. So,
phenomenal work.
Has asked, do you find any difficulty that when you're resheathing the device after putting in these, making these micro cuffs, especially making those 4 vessel fenestrations, how difficult is it to resheath in these cases?
Yeah. Okay, that's a very, very valid question. So, we don't use, let's say we're going to make cuffed fenestrations on a valiant graft. Now, the valiant graft, it comes in 22 French, 24 French, and 25 French. The up to 32 mm diameter comes in 22 French. So, if you take a 32 mm valiant graft, it will have the least amount of space inside the graft sheath. So we try to avoid the largest for a particular French size. So we will try to avoid 32. The next one is avoid 40, because the 40 is the largest in 24 French, and 46 is the largest in 25 French. So we try to use one below the largest so that there is some room outside the graft, inside the graft cover. The second thing we do is we don't make 2 fenestrations which are cuffed exactly at the same level if you can avoid it. So we try to make one little up and one little down so that they don't fight for the same space. Yeah. So if you do these 2 things, it's okay. We don't have a problem resheathing.
So one question from Dr. Anoop, will you artificially distance between the celiac and SMA fenestrations, even if they are close enough in type 5 thoracic aneurysm?
I didn't understand that. Do you?
Is it that if your celiac and SMA are very close to each other, then would you create separate fence for them, or would you just look at one
scalp? No. We would make separate fenestrations because you won't get a seal. If it is like two ostia right next to each other, there is no landing zone that is common. So you have to have two fenestrations and two separate stents to get a good seal. But you saw one case I showed where the celiac and SMA have a common origin. Absolutely. And the first branch is quite a way in. So there is a landing zone. So there we were able to put a large fluency and get a seal.
Right. Then Dr. P.C. Gupta would want to know again the rationale and how to do the pre-cannulation that he's talking about.
Cannulation,
which we do, I think we also do. And if you could explain again, what do you do in the pre-cannulation, just to make it very clear why we are doing and what we are doing.
Okay, so the pre-cannulation is basically passing a wire through the fenestration and both ends of the wire come out through the groin at the end of the delivery. So you can pass a catheter over this wire and cross the fenestration very reliably because the wire is there. And once you cross the fenestration, you pass a parallel wire through the same catheter into the branch that you want to cannulate. And once you are into that branch, you remove this wire loop and advance the catheter into that target artery. Then you can change to a stiff wire, bring a long sheath and deploy a stent. So it is basically to make it easy to cross the fenestration. So once your fenestration is cannulated, you are sure at least you will cross the fenestration. Right. You may not enter the target artery, like in one case where we failed to get a renal. Yeah. But because you can cross the fenestration, we were able to put a plug and close off that fenestration. Yeah.
So just to elaborate further, the distal end of the wire which is there, the one which is basically across the fenestration, that is basically tacked inside the sheath of the device, which is the
device. There is a gray pusher rod in which there is a hollow space. So it is basically packed into that. And then when you remove the delivery system, that end will come out of the femoral artery. So both ends will be out of the femoral artery. You can get good control. You can remove the wire by pulling either end.
Right. Great.
Yeah. So thanks for this talk.
Yeah, one more question from Dr. Meda is that using PTFE graph or cuff, can we use Dacron? To my mind, we use something which is more smoother. So PTFE is definitely much smoother. What will be your take on that one?
For making these cuff fenestrations, we want a graph that is as low profile as possible. So this thin wall ePTFE is what we use.
Right.
And so that has we want to have as little bulk as possible. So there, and so we trim the length also to 4 mm. So that also reduces the bulk.
Right. Amrish Satwik, my colleague, is asking, so the mini cuffs are projecting out about 4 millimeters. And do you feel that, is it the Cook device which is better suited for mini cuffs, or it works both with Medtronic as well as the Cook device or any other device?
It works well for both. It's a question of what is the diameter of the endograft. Now, if it is less than that of the aorta, then you have space around the graft to work. So any company which makes a graft that's small enough to be smaller than the patient's visceral aorta is fine. So there is nothing special about Cook, except that they have this fantastic 10 mm tapered graft, which is 32, 22 is the smallest they have. And that has this great advantage that 32 can seal on top and 22 is floating free in the aneurysm and with space around it for you to work. Right. So that's a very nice advantage. So in one piece, you finish off these two functions.
So one part of troubleshooting that we face commonly, and yesterday, in fact, Dr. Vijay Thakur was also showing a case where when you have a lot of angulated anatomy, the troubleshooting part comes when you have to retrieve the device, you have to resheath the device and then bring it down. Many a time because of cannulation, because of the tortuosity and the angulation and sometimes a lot of calcium, your device tends to, it just doesn't come into the sheath again and it gets caught up in one of the barbs. How often have you faced this situation, and how would you manage those kind of situations?
When you're
taking the nose cone back, when you're finished deploying the device, now you want to take it back, and you have a badly angled aorta. Normally, you would like to bring it in the straight course and then resheath the device, right?
Right.
Sometimes you have a problem where you have an angulated end out there, and then you're not able to, bring down your nose cone down, and it gets stuck inside. Either it gets caught to one of the barbs or something of the sort. So, what would you do in those?
The barb should be actually pointing outwards.
It tends to get caught in the edge of the thing, basically, because of that nose cone. The tip of the edge of the nose cone tends to get stuck in that thing.
Understand. That is a tough situation. I think you have to try to push back up and release that catch. Otherwise,
showing one case where he was doing it and he pulled a strut down in that one. The bare strut of the device got fractured and broke down. He did show one case out there. I do remember. So I think one has to be like what we do is many a times is basically take a terumo wire to reduce the stiffness of the whole thing, and then the system becomes a little softer, and then you can pull it down. So I don't know whether you face this problem, but we do see it in angulated anatomy quite
a bit. Getting a nose cone out can be challenging, especially with the endurant in the abdominal aorta where there's a lot of angulation. There what we have done is try to push it up and then make sure that the cone is nicely fitted onto that spindle. There shouldn't be a gap over there.
Atul has mentioned, and this is something that the company people also sometimes tell you, that push the abdomen on a side, that you keep on pumping the abdomen on one side and it tends to get disengaged. I wonder how it works, but apparently it does work.
The other thing is to rotate it. If you rotate it, it usually works.
But
pushing the abdomen thing has worked for me on occasion.
Right.
It just changes the geometry by a few degrees.
Yeah. Okay. So what we do, Robbie, is that we just put in a terumo in those cases. We replace the stiff wire with a terumo, or bring the soft end of the Lundquist wire inside, and then, toggle it a little bit. So it tends to work most of the time, So this happened with us last week also, which I'll probably share the case next time when we show. So that's one thing. How do you see the role of IVUS in these situations? Because many a times, the vessels, you can't see the origin and all. Of course, we know that the role of IVUS is there in type B dissections and all. How do you see the role of IVUS in tackling these complex aneurysms?
I don't know if IVUS will make such a difference, but if we get fusion imaging, that might make things simpler. So if you have fusion imaging, you don't need to go and mark all these vessels. So that itself saves about 45 minutes. So that is why the Western operators, they come out so much faster. And while they're trying to cannulate in any view, they know where is the target. Correct. So I guess that
technology in our latest cath lab in Gangaram. So we are using that. It really works very well. It's beautiful, actually. We showed it. So I think that is something which is absolutely, divine. It makes your life so easy to look at that. So a couple of more questions, George. I still have a battery of questions, but I will let the other people take up. From Dr. Ashwin Tumkur, how do you decide on length of device when you have very tortuous angle large aneurysm to avoid missing the distal part of aneurysm from exclusion? So again, look at the role of center line, or how do you really, do your measurements and all? Because when you have a tortuous anatomy, you can never be right in terms of the length that you measure. You always require more.
I think it is always better to think of a two-piece solution. So you have two long grafts, which are significant. If you add them up, it should be significantly more than the aneurysm. And then you deploy the first one, and then the second one, when you're deploying, you're only worrying about the distal end. And you've got enough overlap because you've selected two long grafts. So this is typically seen in the descending thoracic aorta where there's a lot of tortuosity. If you do center line and do a calculation, and you add, say, 5 centimeters, invariably you go short. Yeah. So it is best to plan a endograft solution and have a lot of extra overlap. There's no harm in overlapping. You don't lose anything. You gain a lot by having that margin for error. So a two-endograft solution is always good in tortuous anatomy.
Right. So one very interesting question from my colleague, Dr. Ajay Yadav, the pre-cannulation wire and Cook can be brought out through the four French catheter that you showed just now very nicely, but there is no hollow tube in the Endurant device. So how do you manage to bring the pre-cannulation wire to the groin?
No, there is an Endurant device. You make a hole in the sheath cover just under the graft, and it comes out of that hole. Same thing for the Valiant. Valiant also, there is no hollow tube. So the wires will be running parallel to the delivery system the delivery system. So when it goes in, there will be this delivery system and these number of wires going running parallel to it. So it will be like that.
Yeah. Great. So one more question from my side, George. How often do you see this when you're creating these fenestrations in the distal part of the endograft and you have to deploy a device where you have just got to flush it, absolutely with the renals or even up to the SMA? And when you take up the device, it tends to get sucked inside into the aorta, into the thoracic aorta many a times. Has it happened with you sometimes? Or you would first layer the one on top if you have a thoracic aneurysm, which is extended down up to the, and you have to seal up to the SMA or renals.
Yeah, so I get
sucked up sometime.
Yeah, I get you. It tends to migrate up. So always deploy from top to bottom. That is very, very important. Right. If you reverse that order, you may have a upward migration of the endograft.
So that you always use two grafts also in those kind of situations.
Yeah, and especially when you're bringing the second endograft, it may just touch this and push it up, Right. So always do from top to bottom and always have an oversize. Like supposing the top endograft is ending 30, your lower one should be at least 32. And you need at least 5 centimeters of overlap between the two endografts. Then you get a solid structure created from top to bottom.
Right. And my last question, which is there, is that how often would you take a device from the axillary approach, because of certain issues and all? How often would you do that? Or you would always consider going from the groin upwards and all? So what are the situations where you would consider doing that?
Yeah, so we've actually used the axillary approach for bringing in Endurant aortic tubes. And we have actually fenestrated these aortic tubes. So if you have a type 5, let us say type 5 thoracoabdominal ending above the renals. So right. you deploy a Valiant up to the celiac, and then you bring this Endurant tube, which has two fenestrations, one for the celiac, one for the SMA, from the axillary. And then you deploy it ending just above the renals. And then you have the two fenestrations looking anteriorly for the SMA celiac. So that way you can manage with a Valiant plus an Endurant tube and right. just two fenestrations. And then here the free flow and the barbs are looking down. So right. it sort of locks in at the lower end. And then there's this overlap. So we used to do that, but now we want to finish everything femoral and not have a large axillary access as far as possible. Right. So we now use axillary access only for deploying fenestration stents and where the branches are downward oriented. Then right. you may need an axillary access.
Right. I think we've come to the end of this presentation, but before I let you go, I just want to read out a few comments which people have put on the chat box. And the last one is from Dr. Raghuram Lakshmi Narayan. He says, a fantastic presentation from one of my favorite mentors. Where is the limit when you would want a proper branch graft rather than a mini cuff?
That is a tough call, because at the moment we're finding that the mini cuff is working in almost every situation. So I haven't yet seen a situation where I would want a branch over a mini cuff. Maybe, I don't know where it will be. Maybe some very giant aneurysm where the target artery is very far away.
Right.
Maybe in that situation, you want to have a robust starting point. So a branch may give you more strength at the starting point because the overlap is more than a mini cuff. So maybe a giant aneurysm is with a target vessel very far away.
Yeah.
Maybe that one.
One last question from Dr. Nitin. What about direct target vessel peak annulation and parachuting the system? Now, I don't know what he means by parachuting, because what I understand is that you pre-wire the renal artery and then go across and target the same thing. I think that's what he means.
I think there is a way where you put a wire into the renal artery outside the graft, and then you cross the fenestration and you bring a snare up this wire, catch it and slide it up over the stiff wire into the renal artery.
Right.
There's a technique like that. I don't know if that is called parachuting, but
that's why I said. So just a few comments which are coming from Harishankar. You have to see to believe it. I had the privilege to assist him. Stupendous work, sir. That is from this one. Then Apurva said, very extensive and informative presentation, sir. Thank you for enlightening us. Then Dr. Sayyed Muhammad Ali Ahmed is from Bangladesh, I think. He said, speechless. Surely it will go in annals of history. And I do agree with him. From Rahul Lakshmi Narayan, it says, truly amazing, sir. Thank you. From Rahul, it says, jaw-dropping work and great work. From Yashpal, you know, I can carry on with this till the cows come home.
No, don't bother. Thanks so much. I really...
From my side, you know, I think I would just give a nice applause for this wonderful. I think the amount of work, the time that you spent in making this presentation also shows your passion for the subject. And it's really, thank you so much, George. I think you really, you know, enlightened 100 plus people in this audience. Yeah, Dr. Sayyed Muhammad Ali Ahmed is from MCH PG from Madurai Medical College. So I think it's been mind-blowing and very informative presentation. Thank you so much, George, for taking on this.
Varinder, can we virtually give a clap to George, everybody?
Yes, absolutely. That's what I wanted to do that. And I think we all need to give a...
Thank you so much. Really appreciate your encouragement. Thank you so much.
People at Auckland on a Saturday evening, I think that talks about the passion and of course the interest of everyone out here. Thank you all. Have a wonderful weekend. And we will come back with George next week. Of course, he's going to be moderating one session on some Andrew. We have some interesting. And of course, with George again. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. See you. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you so much, George.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.